You're watching Beyond Markets, where we bring you up to speed on development outcomes in Africa. I'm Kenneth Igboma, and thank you so much for joining me on Beyond Markets today. Coming up on the show, Nigeria's judiciary is on the spotlight, and ahead of the elections of the Nigerian Bar Association, we'll discuss how to reposition Nigeria's judiciary. You can join the conversation on social media. Let me know what you think. The hashtag to use is Beyond Markets. You can also hit me up at Kenneth Igboma and let me know exactly what you would like to find out from our guest on the show today. Now, Nigeria's judicial system has come under fire in recent years, and conversations around repositioning the judiciary has become rife. As lawyers in Nigeria prepare for the elections of the Nigerian Bar Association, one of the candidates vying for the top spot joins me now for this discussion. He is none other than Dele Adesina. He's a senior advocate of Nigeria and the principal partner of Dele Adesina Legal Practitioners. Thank you so much for your time today, sir. And let's start with understanding Nigeria's judiciary as an institution and how we can get this to the levels we need it to be.
The Nigerian judiciary has been an institution of note and significance well before now. It has made an impact not only in the nation, but also in its own redefined constitutional responsibility of resolving disputes between persons and persons, between individuals and authorities, and between authorities and authorities. It has demonstrated a very important, power of dispute resolution. And the Nigerian judiciary in the past has donated personnel to other judiciaries of African nations, including Chief Justice of some of those other nations. For example, I think Nigerian judiciary has donated the Chief Justice of Gambia at one point or the other. And so we have a very remarkable judiciary. That is not to say that there are no complaints here and there. As an individual, I believe that the highest, the biggest room in the world is the room for improvement. So people want improvement. That is not because the system is bad. It is because they want the system to become better. And that is where I see the judiciary of Nigeria. So I'm involved to ensure that I have a humble contribution in how to make our judiciary better, to satisfy the yearnings of the people, to confirm more trust and confidence in the minds of the people.
All right, but let's understand now, because the autonomy of the judiciary is also very important if it's going to, perform its functions as instituted in the Constitution. And I'd like to get your views on this and the separation of powers.
Under the Constitution of Federal Republic of Nigeria, 1999, 4, 5, and 6 of the Constitution are very clear. Section 4 grants the legislative powers to the legislature, which is one arm of government. Section 5 confers executive powers on the executive arm of government. And of course, Section 6 of the Constitution confers judicial powers. These are the three. So under the constitutional structure that we operate in Nigeria, there is a clear separation of powers. I must hasten to add that there are some, symbiotic relationships between the three arms of government, particularly in the appointment procedure. For example, why the arm of the judiciary, here in the National Judicial Council, we make recommendation for appointment of judges at the federal, and the State Judicial Service Commission in the respective state, we also make recommendations to the executive, to the executive of the state. The executive will forward to the legislature for their own investigations and approval. After that, it comes back from the legislative arm of government to the executive, who we announce the appointment. This is not a controlling power. It is a It's about the relationship to ensure checks and balances between one arm of government and the other. So I will say, under our constitution, we have separation of powers duly defined out. With regard to the independence of the judiciary, I will also want to say, without any hesitation whatsoever, that the Constitution has provided for the independence of the judiciary. It has given them opportunity to operate without interference. It has given them opportunity to operate independently. However, we know human elements and we know human attitudes and thoughts in the operations of the constitutional provisions. Therefore, what the law is as clear as I have itemized it to be, there is a responsibility on the part of the judge to insist on his independence. That is a responsibility nobody can take from him or her. Even if there are extenuating circumstances that may compel or that may warrant or harass or intimidate you, you as a judge must not allow that intimidation. This is very, very crucial. Now, in terms of attitudinal factor, there are instances where, yes, a few orders, rulings, and judgment of the court may have been disobeyed. It is the responsibility of that court to insist on the powers conferred by the Constitution in order to enforce its orders and judgments.
All right, but let's understand, as someone who is vying for the top spot of the NBA, Nigerian Bar Association, I would like to get what your take on what the NBA's role is in ensuring that we have a united and lawful Nigeria.
The Nigerian Bar Association, I see it as a catalyst for advancement of the nation. I see the Nigerian Bar Association as a pressure group to ensure that orders of court are obeyed, to ensure that law and order are maintained in the country. I see a Nigerian Bar Association that will constructively engage and collaborate with government and the law enforcement agencies to ensure that our laws are not just exist in the books, but are obeyed on the streets. So we have a role to play here. But of course, the Nigerian Bar Association is not the police that we execute the laws. It's not the legislature that we make the laws. But we can constructively engage and collaborate with these institutions that are defined by actively playing the role, the supportive role, to make it better. Number two, we can also play a very prominent role in sustaining democracy in Nigeria by ensuring that the rights and fundamental rights of individuals are obeyed, by ensuring that the rule of law, which is the basis of any constitutional democracy, is protected and defended in Nigeria. By the time the opposition is doing these things that are mentioned, they will be supporting our constitutional democracy. All over the world today, democracy has become an issue of life and death. In terms of even civilization of nations today, is determined by the kind of government that they operate, or the system of government that they operate. And no system today is recognized anywhere in the world than democracy, the government of the people, by the people, and for the people. In addition to this, the NBA will be helping to strengthen the unity of the country by campaigning for a strong judicial institution. And how can our institution be stronger than what it is now? The NBA must campaign and canvass in a sustainable manner for adequate funding of the judiciary, for proper remuneration and emoluments for the judicial staff. We must also work in a sustainable manner to reduce the workload in this course, particularly the apex course, The Nigerian Supreme Court is the busiest court in this. I mean, some people have said it's the busiest Supreme Court in the world. They handle all manner of cases, including interlocutory appeals. We need, as an organization, as a Nigerian Bar Association, to propose and canvass for how we can take some of these loads to somewhere else, energizing alternative dispute resolution, stopping interlocutory appeals to the Supreme Court, so on and so forth. There is even an agitation by some people in this country, and this has been going on for some time, that we consider establishment of constitutional courts to take over some of the political cases that we have, so as to free the Supreme Court of time to consider other matters, commercial and other disputes. So the NBA can also look at the merit or the merit of these campaigns and then push it forward by reason of the advantage position as an association of lawyers in this country. I think the time has also come when we should canvass how we can federalize the judicial institution in order to deal decisively with the problem of delay and congestion in our courts. These are some of the things the NBA can do in order to make this nation better. When people get justice, timely, they will have faith in the nation. We lawyers say that justice delayed, justice denied. I must confess that one of the biggest problems that we have in our judiciary is the issue of delay. And delay itself has resulted into congestion in our courts. And a duty and responsibility to deal with this delay congestion is clearly on the laps of the Nigerian Bar Association. So by the time we make the judiciary better and faster, we are making this court resolution to be better and faster for the people in the nation. And when that happens, the people will have more faith in their nation and there will be greater unity. When people do not get justice, the problem. Somebody says that a nation can endure with unbelief. If you like, believe. If you don't like, don't believe. But no nation can endure with injustice. Injustice must be dealt with and it must be uprooted. So whatever is standing in the way of justice administration, fast, expeditious determination of cases must be looked at and dealt with.
All right, Mr. Anishina, I need you to hold that thought for a second. We're going to take a short break now. And definitely when we return, I'm going to engage you more on the administration of justice and we're going to find out what you think going forward. I've been speaking to Dele Adesina. He's the principal partner and the senior advocate of Nigeria, principal partner of Dele Adesina Legal Practitioners. We'll bring you more on Beyond Markets after the break. Hello and welcome to Beyond Markets. If you're just joining us, my guest today is Dele Adesina. He's the principal partner for Dele Adesina Legal Practitioners. He's also a senior advocate of Nigeria. And just before the break, he was just talking a lot about the administration of justice in Nigeria. And Mr. Adesina, I would like to put this question to you and I'll try to understand how we can get fair and equitable rulings in any political setting in the country.
There are two sides to every dispute. It is very important for us to know that when you submit that dispute to court resolution, one side must win while the other side must necessarily lose. The two of them cannot win unless the dispute is resolved amicably out of court. Having said that, a situation where people will fight a case from the High Court to Court of Appeal, from Court of Appeal to the Supreme Court, The system expects anybody to abide and accept the decision of the Supreme Court, which is the final court of the land. Whether you are the winner or you are the loser at the Supreme Court. And the Supreme Court, the Court of Appeal, and other courts are constituted under our law to guarantee their opportunity to deliver rulings, judgments, without fear of favor, affection, or ill will. As a matter of fact, that is the oath of office of every judicial officer. But the problem is, what I will put squarely on the lap of the Nigerian politicians. They are disputing over a matter. They voluntarily submit the matter to court determination, and the two of them want to win at the same time. It is not possible. If you will always say that, after a judgment has been given, the one that succeeds, in the case we say Daniel has come to judgment, and the one that loses will not be magnanimous enough to say, even though I disagree with the judgment, I accept it as the final resolution in this matter, then we are in problem. And that is what I have seen in Nigeria. These are some of the things that are casting unnecessary aspersion in our judiciary. The two sides to a dispute want to win, and it is not possible. So I think here too, the NBA, we now have to embark on sustained enlightenment campaign that unless you respect the judiciary and abide by the decision of the judiciary, if you don't win today, you can win tomorrow. Don't, because of the fact that you lose today, destroy the institution or the system.
Yeah, Mr. Adesina, I'd like to get your role on one very critical issue, which I think we should address as well, because it's one of the elephants in the room. And I would like to know how the Nigerian Bar Association can help to strengthen, first, the judicial integrity and as well as capacity.
This is not unrelated to what I said earlier. Respect for the judiciary is non-negotiable. Having trust and confidence in the judiciary is fundamental. The willingness to accept the decision of our courts must also be total, whether they are in favor or they are not in favor. If these three things are in place, we will be strengthening the integrity of our courts. But when people lose a matter, and then they begin to cast aspersions, oh, the judge has taken bribe, oh, the judge is a friend of so-so person, oh, the judge has done this, he has done that, we are casting aspersions, we are reducing the integrity, we are putting a mark on the integrity of the judiciary. And let me say this, the name you give your child is the name outsiders will call him. So if you, as a national in this country, you go before the court, and because you lose your case, you now begin to name all manner of names, you are not helping the institution. If you want to help the institution, like I said, you will accept the finality of the decision of the court, particularly the highest court of the land. So the sure way you can enhance the integrity of our court is by accepting their decisions. The other way is by obeying those decisions. When you disobey the decision of our courts, you are putting question mark on the integrity and on the capacity of our court. There is no other institution that has the capacity to resolve disputes in this country other than the judiciary, except, of course, where you resolve into alternative dispute resolution. Particularly in political cases, I am not very aware if there are some that have been resolved through alternative dispute resolution. It has always been going to court, whether by way of pre-election matter or by way of post-election matters. at the different election tribunals, you know. But it is understandable that politicians want to win. They don't want to lose. But court system does not work that way. The capacity of the judiciary to stabilize the nation is founded in their, you know, in that taking matters, deciding on these matters without fear or favor, like I said earlier, and in getting people to obey their decisions. Another thing to enhance the capacity of our courts is adequate funding. There was a time in this country, precisely between 2010 and 2014, the budgetary allocation to the judiciary in this was always on a downward trend. Between 2015 and now, it has increased, but the authority can still do much, much better. We need to fund the judiciary. We need to improve the infrastructural facilities that exist in the judiciary. So adequate funding is one of the things that are militating against the capacity of our courts. Justice is not cheap.
All right, Mr. Deshina.
We must be ready and prepared to fund the judiciary so that we can also obtain maximum justice.
All right, Mr. Deshina, very quickly, yes, I want to throw in this last question. I'd like you to be very concise with your answer. And I'm trying to understand, someone who's vying for a position, a top position like that at the NBA, I want to know what your suggestions are on how to mitigate the impact of the COVID-19 on judicial processes.
First and foremost is the issue of funding that I have just talked about. There is going to be a massive introduction of technology in our judicial system. Virtual hearings will be more. Now, how do you get this done? It's not going to be a fire brigade approach. It is going to be a carefully calculated step, because migrating from manual to technological hearing in our justice administration will require careful planning. Now, infrastructures are not there. They must be provided. The judges must be trained. It will not be an overstatement if I say that the lawyers are already training themselves into how to get into new dispensation. We cannot avoid digital hearing in the light of this COVID-19 pandemonium. Not only that, training is key. Some of the courts may have to be restructured, because it is not going to be a case of a judge just putting a system in front of him or her. I think virtual hearing can effectively be taken. So, courtrooms may have to be reconditioned with equipment fixed and put in place. Generator has to be provided. Power supply must also be enhanced in this course.
Quite a lot of work ahead for the judiciary. Definitely. Thank you so much for your time on the show. I'm afraid that's all we have time for on Beyond Markets today. Quite a lot of work ahead for you, and I wish you all the best as you go on in that elections. I've been speaking to Dele Adesina. He's the principal partner of Dele Adesina Legal Practitioners, and he's also a senior advocate of Nigeria. And that's it on Beyond Markets for today. And thank you so much for being a part of the show. But remember, you can catch the show at 5 p.m. West African time daily and have access to all episodes of Beyond Markets on our website. That's at cnbcafrica.com. For me and the team, enjoy the rest of your day.